you be going to Paris?
I will not be going to Paris, but Manga Bay has three correspondents who will be there, so they'll be covering the action.
Well, we'll look for that. You do operate a new site that's become a hub for vital information. Are there other stories from Indonesia that have caught your attention and maybe make you worry a bit?
Oh, well, there's plenty to worry about in Indonesia right now. So even before the fires, there was huge concern about kind of this backlash against these companies that have adopted zero deforestation commitments. So the government, and, you know, it's a little bit hard to define who in the government, but let's say elements in the government have been very strongly opposed to these zero deforestation commitments. And again, these zero deforestation commitments have emerged as a response to consumers and companies who are concerned about being associated with destructive practices. And so a bunch of U.S., European, Canadian companies have established safeguards for palm oil and other commodity sourcing, which basically says we will not buy palm oil to produce at the expense of rainforest, peatlands, or as a result of human rights abuses. And so these Indonesian companies, several Indonesian companies have adopted these policies, but the Indonesian government is now putting pressure on these companies to not maintain those policies, to, you know, not respect them. And at the same time, there's still a lot of other companies that are not part of those agreements that, you know, sell to other markets, especially domestic markets, that continue to destroy forests. And so that's a very troubling development in that, you know, the big companies that are trying to do the right thing may not be allowed to do the right thing because they'll be pressured by the government.
Are we going to see some species extinctions there the way things are going?
Well, we've already seen some species extinctions in Indonesia. They've lost two species of tiger, the Javan tiger and the Bali tiger. The Sumatran tiger is, you know, the last tiger in Indonesia. It's critically endangered. They estimate around 400 of those. I mean, honestly, I don't think they'll go extinct, but they could definitely be more and more threatened. But really, there's a lot of species that have never been, you know, science has not documented in Indonesia that are probably disappearing. It is a huge concern, and there's just less and less habitat, especially in Sumatra. I mean, Sumatra's forests and peatlands have been just really heavily wrecked by the various plantation industries and these fires.
I'm trying to picture what Indonesia will look like in 2050. I was there in 1990, so that seems like ages ago, and it's changed a lot since then. Will it be stripped of its tropical forests? Will it be one giant agricultural factory feeding other economies? Rhett, what's the worst and the best you can see for Indonesia?
Well, just to provide some context, since you were there in 1990, Sumatra has lost half of its forest cover that existed then.
Wow.
So it's pretty staggering how much has been lost. And so what tends to happen is that once the forest is converted, then it becomes an oil palm plantation or it's left as wasteland. So a lot of the area that's burning right now is essentially wasteland, not used by anyone. It's, you know, just dead. It's not good for anything. And so it's a huge loss. And so, you know, that's happening now, has happened to most of Sumatra. It's spreading into Kalimantan, you know, oil palm, coal mines, timber plantations. And what's really worrying to conservationists and also scientists is what's going to happen in Indonesian New Guinea. So that's the real last frontier now, and it's really being opened up quickly for these projects that have questionable economic value that, you know, will be environmentally and culturally devastating.
In our country, you're free, and so you're born, and so they say, you're free. So happy birthday. And even if you're born to lose, even if you're a complete wreck when you were born, you might still grow up to be president because you're free.
Today you might be an average citizen, a civilian, a pedestrian, but tomorrow you might be elected to some unexpected office or sell your novel and suddenly become famous. Or you could get run over by a truck and your picture could get into the papers that way. Because you're free, and anything might happen, so happy birthday.
Gee, all those lights and all those screens. The New York experience is mind-boggling. I don't think I've ever seen that many screens before, and I'll probably come again. It was really amazing, mind-boggling.
You're walking, and you don't always realize it, but you're always falling at the same time. With each step, you fall forward. over and over you're falling, then catching yourself falling. And this is how you can be walking and falling at the same time.
Look, over there, it's a real dog, and it's really talking.
I wanted you, and I was looking for you, but I couldn't find you. I wanted you, and I was looking for you all day, but I couldn't find you. I couldn't find you.
Well, I paid my money, and I've got this funny feeling that somehow, you know, it's not what I paid my money for. I mean, I paid my money, and I just don't think this is what I paid my money. You know, what I paid my money for.
No one has ever looked at me like this before. No one has ever stared at me for so long like this. This is the first time anyone has ever looked at me like this, stared at me like this for such a long time, for so long.
Well, he didn't know what to do, so he decided to just watch the government and see what the government was doing and kind of scale it down to size and run his life that way.
She said the hardest thing to teach her three-year-old kid was what was alive and what wasn't. The phone rings, and she holds it out to her kid and says, "It's Grandma. Talk to Grandma." But she's holding a piece of plastic, and the kid says, "Hey, wait a minute. Is the phone alive? Is the TV alive? What about that radio? What is alive in this room and what isn't?" Unfortunately, she doesn't know how to ask these questions.
We were in a large room full of people, all kinds, and they'd all arrived at the same time. They were all free, and they were all asking themselves the same question. What is behind that curtain? They were all free, and they were all wondering what would happen next.
This is the time, and this is the record of the time. This is the time, and this is the record of the time.
And so there is Syria, which is, you know, arguably the most biodiverse country on Earth, could be biologically impoverished in the next, you know, 30 to 40 years if these trends continue.
Unless we could turn it around somehow, and I haven't given up hope for Indonesia, and I know the people of Indonesia haven't either.
Yeah, so I mean, there are some reasons for hope in Indonesia. I mean, I think the sad fact is sometimes it takes a crisis for people to really to shock people into action, and I think that this haze could do that. So in 2013, there was also a severe haze. It was not at the level that we're seeing now, but the difference was is the wind patterns pushed a lot of that air pollution over Singapore, and Singapore was not happy about that at all, and so they passed a law which allowed them to sue international companies for causing haze. And so that actually triggered real legislation that's trying to be enforced now. And so I think by that same mechanism, the fact that the haze is so severe right now that it could really force the government and companies to try to address this issue. So that's one important thing. Another is that today we can see more than ever what's actually happening on the ground. So there's this amazing platform called Global Forest Watch, which aggregates all different sorts of forest data from around the world. From satellites to on-the-ground information. And that's really giving us a much better idea of what's happening. And so, you know, there's a potential for companies to essentially get, you know, blacklisted or just develop a really bad reputation because we can see that within their concessions that they're chopping down forests. So it's a new way to pressure companies. Another major development has been the government's new willingness to look at traditional land rights. And so a lot of the forests that remain in Indonesia are essentially belong to communities, so they're managed by communities. But the problem has been that the government hasn't recognized the rights of those communities, and so there would be a community forest. The government would then grant a concession to a logging or a plantation company. That company would come in and basically take that forest away from the communities, cut it down, and convert it for, you know, the plantation. But if
yeah.
traditional rights are recognized, then there's hope that those forests can be protected instead of being converted. There's certainly some positive developments. I think a model that Indonesia is very interested in is what's happened in Brazil. So in 2004, Brazil's deforestation rate was sky high. It was at a recent peak. Since 2004, the annual rate of clearing has fallen by more than 80%. And at the same time, the Brazilian economy has expanded. So I recognize the Brazilian economy right now is not doing so great. But if you look at kind of the macro numbers, Brazil greatly increased its agricultural output while also dramatically reducing deforestation. So that really suggested that you can still expand food production and grow your economy without destroying the environment. They're not opposites of each other. And so that's provided a model that Indonesia could potentially follow by shifting agricultural expansion to non-forest lands, having better law enforcement, things like that to disaggregate economic growth from forest destruction.
And you were an economist, were you not?
Well, I wasn't an economist. I mean, my undergraduate degree was in finance and economics. So my approach is a little bit different. I don't have a background as I guess an environmentalist or an ecology. My background is really at looking at the business side of things and how the economics work. And so that's what kind of drives Mongabay in terms of our perspective.
Well, I think we've all got to do a lot more of what you're doing, get the word out. But also as consumers, as citizens, we have to recognize we are global citizens. So, a lot of Americans, Canadians, Westerners don't know much about Indonesia and don't think they have to know about Indonesia. But I think this crisis has brought out that what happens anywhere in the world can affect our sea levels in New England and the growing conditions in California and on and on. We have to know what's happening all over the world.
It's definitely true. I mean, the actions that we take here at home have a big impact, on the other side of the planet. I mean, there's no doubt about it between habitat destruction, climate change, and even rainfall patterns. So, researchers have found these, they call them teleconnections between forests driving moisture to the United States. And so if we lose forests and the Amazon, it could affect rainfall in Chicago. So certainly something to think about.
What are you working on now? Do you have a big project in mind?
Well, Mongabay always has a bunch of projects, but two of our big initiatives right now. One is launching the equivalent of what we have in Indonesia across Spanish-speaking Latin America. So we would have a hub in either Peru or Colombia, and then we have correspondents from Mexico to Argentina and Chile. So broad representation across the region, doing daily news reporting on environmental and conservation issues. So it's obviously a huge market. There's a lot of demand for it, and there's currently not an international Spanish environmental news service that really covers that. So there's monthly services, but doing the same that we've done in Indonesia, which in Indonesia it's just been such a great model. It's been highly successful. We've had the president of Indonesia reference the site. So the goal is to do the same thing in Latin America. The other big new initiative for us is called Wild Tech. It's wildtech.mongabay.com. And it's looking at emerging technology and how it's applied to conservation. So the problem in this space is not that technology, isn't being used. It's that it's not being very well documented. And so there's a lot of hype. And so trying to separate the hype from what actually works. So this site, it's an initiative between Manga Bay, a group called Resolve, and World Resources Institute. And there's about 20 scientists involved right now. And so it's field scientists. So really practical insight on what's actually been tried and works in the field, but also what hasn't worked, because we need to learn from our mistakes as much as we learn from what works. So the site has interviews with practitioners, it has how-tos, it has product reviews, as well as articles and things like that. So we really see it as a platform for disseminating information on, you know, how technology can be used in conservation. So that's everything from, you know, mobile apps to drones to sensors on the ground to data processing for satellite imagery and things like that.
And Google balloons floating over Indonesia to hook up the net.
Right, exactly. So you need to be connected in a lot of these related applications. So, you know, they say it's 3 to 5 years away. I don't know if I believe that, but internet connectivity is definitely important for a lot of these things to work.
We've been talking with Rhett Butler, founder of MangaBay.com. He's become an expert in demand on tropical places and how to communicate what is happening there. You can tell your kids about it with Rhett's photo book, simply called Rainforests. I'll toss some links to all things Rhett Butler in my own blog at ecoshock.info if you missed any during this interview. Be sure and check out his spectacular coverage of the Indonesian fire crisis. Rhett, thank you for joining us, and please come back again.
All right, well, thank you for having me. It's been a pleasure.
I'm Alex Smith reporting for Radio EcoShock.
Ready? Oh, Superman. Oh, John.
This is the Radio EcoShock special on the fires in Indonesia, called The Greatest Climate Crisis of This Century. I'm Alex Smith. Here is yet another aspect of the Indonesian peat fires. Despite the sky-high emissions coming out of the tropics right now, that could be just a preview for an even bigger show. I'm talking about peat in the Arctic and the subarctic. A lot of people worry about methane, but watch out for the peat. The peat areas in the far north are even more vast than in Indonesia. Currently, a huge portion of that is frozen all year round in the permafrost.
Oh, Mom and Dad. Mom and Dad. Hi. I'm not home right now. But if you want to leave a message, just start talking at the sound of the tone. Hello? This is your mother. Are you there? Are you coming home?
Just a few years ago, I listened to expert permafrost scientists at the convention of the American Association for the Advancement of Science in Vancouver. They were then a fringe study slowly being recognized as key to our future. Those scientists were not overly worried, thinking melting of the permafrost would take centuries, if not thousands of years. Now, we're not so sure about that. For example, scientists working in a tunnel in Alaska found that melting Arctic soil can lose half its organic carbon in only 7 days. About 50% of that carbon was grabbed by microorganisms. The other half went into the atmosphere in just 1 week upon thawing. The study is titled Ancient Low Molecular Weight Organic Acids in Permafrost Fuel, Rapid Carbon Dioxide Production Upon Thaw, with lead author Travis W. Drake, and published in September 2015 by PNAS, the Proceedings of the National Academy of Sciences. Find a link in my show blog at ecoshock.info. We know permafrost is thawing all across Alaska, Canada, Scandinavia, and Siberia much faster than expected. The study looked at a type of Arctic soil called yodoma that was formed about 35,000 years ago and kept in the deep freeze ever since. Scientists assumed yodoma was already degraded, but instead found it contains significant carbon. Arctic peat bogs contain even more carbon by a large margin. They're loaded with it. The largest permafrost peat bog is in western Siberia. It's bigger than France and Germany combined, and it's been thawing for well over a decade. If these bogs stay wet, most of the emissions will be in the form of methane, the greenhouse gas at least 70 times more powerful than carbon dioxide. If a climate drought dries the Arctic peat, it will release carbon dioxide pretty quickly, even without catching fire. The ancient plant material, frozen for over 10,000 years, will finally decompose into the atmosphere. Of course, drier peat is likely to catch fire, as fires in the rapidly warming Arctic have been so rampant so far this century. When peat bogs bigger than most countries catch fire, there is no one there to put them out, and no way to extinguish them if we tried. If and when this happens, it will be Indonesia on steroids. Some scientists say the burning peat has already begun. Other science shows there is about a 40-year time lag between a large injection of greenhouse gases like that in Indonesia and the start of real climate impacts. Dr. James Hansen and others published a paper which estimated about 60% of the effects of added greenhouse gases would kick in between 25 and 50 years. This is mainly because the ocean absorbed so much carbon and then mixed it down to deeper levels. It served like a buffer in time, but eventually that carbon comes out. Theoretically, about half the impacts of the Indonesian carbon burst of 2015 would appear around the year 2055. Thawing of Arctic peat would change the climate towards the end of this century. I have serious reservations about this estimate. I think it's likely the timetables will have to be revisited. First of all, there have been a series of papers in the past 2 years showing the climate is far more sensitive to even small temperature changes than previously thought. Secondly, the oceans are already hotter than before and loaded with carbon. That's why they're turning acidic. Some scientists wonder how much more carbon and heat they can uptake. The ocean sink may be ramping down, meaning climate impacts would come sooner. Everything is coming sooner. Now, I'm not a scientist, but my guess is we'll see the impacts from the 2015 emissions as early as 2030. Even if I'm wrong, global emissions started to skyrocket around 1990. That means we'll find out what we've done around 2030. Right now, according to Hansen's estimates, we're only feeling the impacts of oil, gas, and coal burning from the 1970s. Greenhouse gas emissions were 75% lower in the 1970s compared to 2004. And look at the record storms, rainfall, drought, and fires we've already got. When it comes to climate disruption, the worst is yet to come.
Radio EcoShock.
As we look into the lose-lose column, a scientist from the Potsdam Institute in Germany has calculated if we burn all the fossil fuels, all the ice on Earth will disappear. An article in the New York Times, September 11, 2015, quotes Ricardo Winkelmann saying, "If we burn it all, we melt it all." There's an excellent radio special with short recent talks by Winkelmann, produced by Maria Gallardin of TUC Radio in San Francisco. TUC stands for Time of Useful Consciousness, and this program certainly is. Here's a quick explanation from Winkelmann on why the melting of Greenland is self-sustaining and unstoppable.
The Greenland ice sheet is another tipping element of the climate system, and pushing the Greenland ice sheet across its tipping point basically means that it's going to melt down entirely. The mechanism behind this is really easy to understand. The mechanism basically means that if we lower the surface elevation of the Greenland ice sheet, it will warm, and that warming will lead to additional melting, and then, in turn, lead to more lowering of the surface elevation. So this is a self-enforcing feedback that basically drives that meltdown of the Greenland ice sheet. If it did melt down entirely, sea level would rise by 7 meters globally. And the threshold for this to happen has been estimated to be between 0.8 and 3.2 degrees of additional global warming. Now, this chain of events is really just one example that is to show that there are feedbacks between these tipping elements in the climate system. For the three that I just mentioned, the Greenland and Antarctic ice sheets and the thermohaline circulation, this could be the chain of events and the important processes at work. Tipping of Greenland means freshwater input in the North Atlantic. That in turn will lead to a weakening of the thermohaline circulation. That will lead to southern ocean warming, and that will certainly influence the ice loss from Antarctica. Also, Greenland tipping means sea level rise, as we just saw. 7 meters of sea level rise globally, but especially on the southern hemisphere due to the rotational effect. And these two sort of processes together mean that tipping of Greenland will certainly influence the tipping point of Antarctica. So what can we conclude from this? I think we need to think about business as usual in a different sense as well. Business as usual, that means a 5-degree warming by the end of this century.
Ricarda also says the giant West Antarctic ice sheet is committed to melting, and the subsea-based glaciers of East Antarctica are also going to go. We already know that Miami will go underwater, along with many other port cities around the world, in the next 100 or 200 years. Here's selections from Ricarda Winkleman at the conference Our Common Future on TUC Radio at tucradio.org. That's tucradio.org. In fact, we learned last week that scientists predict by the end of this century, parts of the Middle East will be too hot and humid for humans to be outside for very long. 6 hours outside without air conditioning, and they will die. That's in a paper from the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. The title is Future Temperature in Southwest Asia Projected to Exceed a Threshold for Human Adaptability. That was published October 26, 2015, in the journal Nature Climate Change. Find a link in my blog at ecoshock.info. Other scientists on Radio EcoShock told us a whole belt around the tropics and even into parts of the subtropics will be too hot for humans to work outside. Whether it's fatal to simply be outside depends on a high humidity, because humans can only keep their organs cool enough when sweat can evaporate. Once the wet bulb temperature, that combined measurement of heat and humidity, reaches 35 degrees C, we humans and most mammals cannot live there. Add in the known historical trends of bands of deserts circling the Earth during hothouse ages, and we know that humans will have to leave large parts of the Earth as uninhabitable the way we're going. That's the game we're playing now as we change the atmosphere. So when Indonesia catches fire, we all catch fire in the long run. The world is not an island of isolated events. When the big alarm clock goes off anywhere in the world, we need to wake up, and get to work, making a future worth living in. I'll put a whole bunch of the best links to the Indonesian fire crisis in my show blog, published every Wednesday at ecoshock.info. Help yourself, and please tweet, Facebook, or share this program with as many people as you can. You can use tools found in my blog over on the left-hand side or on our SoundCloud page at soundcloud.com/radioecoshock. I'm Alex Smith. Thank you for listening and caring about our world.
And thank you for listening, my perfect audience. What you think about that? Indonesia, burning. We smoked them out. Highly invasive, corrupt, corrosive capitalism. In the Coke 1% master narrative official story, you can't make this shit up. You can't make it up. It's going along. And it's coming for us like Fukushima. Drink your Fukushima Kool-Aid, because the permafrost is going to carbonate. And the monoxidal mainstream media are carbon footfall is harsh. It's a harsh hegemony there in Paris, COP21, Paris, that other Paris. Close the borders, there's Paul on the road to Damascus. In his mask.
Hello? Is anybody home? Well, you don't know me, but I know you. And I've got a message to give to you. Your long arms.
your heart. So holy mama, in your long arms, your petrochemical arms, your military arms, in your electronic arms.
We're taught to love the worst of us. Mercy more than life, but trust me, mercy's just a warning shot across the bow. I live for yours, and you can't fail me now. I live for your mercy. You can't fail me now. You can't fail me now.
Questioner, I was here last year. Now I am again before you. What makes me come, I really don't know. But somehow, I cannot forget you. Maharaj, some forget, some do not, according to their destinies, which you may call chance if you prefer. Questioner, between chance and destiny, there is a basic difference. Maharaj, only in your mind. In fact, you do not know what causes what in Indonesia or elsewhere. Even in the Arctic, destiny is only a blanket word to cover up your ignorance. Chance is another word. And bird by bird, you arrive at enlightenment, at Inca, at where you are and where you want to be. Questioner, without knowledge of causes and their results, can there be freedom? Maharaj, causes and and results are infinite in number and variety. Everything affects everything. In this universe, when one thing changes in Indonesia, everything changes in New York. Hence the great power of man in changing the Arctic and acidifying the ocean. Changing the world by changing himself. Questioner, according to your own words, you have, by the grace of your guru, changed radically some 40 years ago. Yet the world remains as it had been before. Maharaj, my world has changed completely. Yours remains the same. For you have not changed. Questioner, how is it that your change has not affected me? Maharaj, because there was no communion between us, do not consider yourself as separate from me. and we shall at once share a common state here at Hamlin, here at the Buddhists, artists, Advaita, home for the hospiceless. Questioner, I have some property in the United States which I intend to sell and buy some land in the Himalayas. I shall build a house, lay out a garden, get two or three cows, and live quietly. People tell me that property and quiet aren't compatible, that I shall at once get into trouble with officials, neighbors, thieves. Is that inevitable? Maharaj, the least you can expect is an endless succession of visitors who will make your abode into a free and open guest house, or perhaps an Airbnb. Better accept your life as it shapes. Go home and look after your life and your wife with love, with care, with metta, with compassion, with Mahayana. Nobody else needs you. The world is okay without you. Your dreams of glory will land you in Tsaras. Questioner, is it not glory that I seek? I seek not glory, I seek reality. Maharaj, for this you need a well-ordered and quiet life, peace of mind, and immense, immense earnestness. At every moment, whatever comes to you unasked, serendipitously, you improvise, you inspire at any moment, whatever. What comes unasked comes from God S, and will surely help you if you make the fullest use of it. It is only what you strive for out of your own imagination and desire that gives you trouble. Questioner, is destiny the same as grace? Maharaj, absolutely. Destiny's child is LeBron and Beyonce. Accept life as it comes and you will find it a blessing. Questioner, I can accept my own life, but how can I accept the sort of life that Syrian refugees in SIDS, Serbia, in winter, or in Paris on the streets, are Ethiopians, Eritreans in Israel? How can I accept their lives? Maharaj, you are accepting it anyhow. The sorrows of others do not really interfere with your pleasures, do they? If you were really compassionate, you would have abandoned long ago all your self-serving, self-concern, self-immolation, and entered the state from which alone you can really help anything. Questioner, If I have a big house and enough land, I may create an ashram with individual rooms, a common meditation hall, a canteen, a library, an office, a shrine. Maharaj, ashrams are not made, they happen. You cannot start or prevent one. As you cannot start a startup, an IPO, Airbnb, furniture.com, or FanDuel. You can't stop the river, nor can you push it. There are too many factors involved in the creation of a successful ashram or IPO, angel investors, Bitcoin on blockchains. Of course, if you are ignorant of your real being, whatever you do must turn to ashes. Ashe, ago, habaragani. You cannot imitate the sad guru and get away with it. Get away with driving the getaway car for coke. Cunt. 1% master narrative, official story, Bubba Mice's about surveillance and how it protects us in Syria. You cannot imitate a guru and get away with it. All hypocrisy ends in disaster. American foreign policy notwithstanding, there is a liberated, is the fixated, lumpen level that must be lubricated for Inca. Questioner, what is the harm in behaving like a saint? Acting the part, faking it till you make it. What's the harm? Maharaj, rehearsing saintliness is sadhana, is the practice of intention and intuition. It's improvised. It's inspired. It's perfectly all right. Provided you don't take it personally, no merit is claimed. Questioner, how can I know whether I am able to start an ashram unless I try? Maharaj, as long as you take yourself to be a person, a body-mind, mind the gap, separated from the mainstream media, from the coke 1% master narrative official story, going all the way live. Separate from the stream of life. Have a will of your own. Pursue your own aims. Impersonate yourself. And you live on the surface. And whatever you do is short-lived, like driving the getaway car. It's like a performance 360 evaluation. You eat what you kill. You practice above and beyond the call of booty and duty. What you do will have little value. A drop in the bucket, on your bucket list, a mere straw to feed the flames of vanity. Beyonce, and LeBron. It's O.J. White Justice in the Coke 1% Master Narrative, Trayvon Zimmerman. You must put in true worth before you can expect something real. What is your worth? Questioner, by what measure shall I measure my worth? Maharaj, look at the content of your mind. You are what you think about. You eat what you kill. Are you not most of the time busy with your own little, mean, gaining, end-gaining little person and its daily needs? Do you not take even this here, now, personally? The value of regular meditation is that it takes you away from the humdrum daily routine and reminds you that you are not what you believe yourself to be. But even remembering is not enough. Action must follow your conviction. Don't be like the rich man who has made a detailed will but refuses to die. The Indian peat fires, the Indonesian peat fires. Go on, they smolder. We smoke the mirrors, and the smoking gun for climate change is in Indonesia, is in the Arctic permafrost. Questioner, is not the gradualness the law of life? Maharaj, oh no. The preparation alone is gradual. The change itself, Inca, enlightenment is sudden. Rinzai, complete. The pebble strikes the bamboo and it's all moo. Gradual change does not take you to a new level of conscious being. You need courage to let go. Questioner, I admit it is courage I lack. Maharaj, it is because you are not fully convinced. Complete conviction generates both desire and courage. And meditation is the art of achieving faith through inner standing. In meditation, you consider the teaching moment on the learning curve in all its aspects, and repeatedly until out of clarity, confidence is born as you circle around the stupa and with confidence act. Do what you're supposed to do. Put one foot in front of the other. Conviction and action are inseparable. If action does not follow conviction, examine your convictions. Don't accuse yourself of lack of courage. Self-depreciation will take you nowhere. Without clarity and emotional assent, you can do nothing except take a deep breath and chant. Ah, the time comes too soon. The time passes in the oxit ocean. The vaso-present, ever-present, Frankie Ocean.
The best song wasn't the single, but you weren't either.
living in the dare height. Thank you.
Fabiola Juliet. Juliet, she failed to say. When he put his arms around her, he said, Julia, you know you're my flame. You give me fever. When you kiss me, Captain Smith and Pocahontas had a very mad affair. When her daddy tried to kill him, she said, Daddy, don't you dare give my fever. When he kissed me, fever, when he hold me tight. And fever all through the night. Everybody's got the fever. That is something we all know. Fever isn't such a thing. Fever started long ago. Story. Here's the point I'm trying to say.
Six up on the give you fever.
Well,
be it Fahrenheit or centigrade, they give us fever. When you kiss them, fever when you live in love. Fever. What a lovely way to burn. And what a lovely way to burn. 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 What a You're listening, in case you were wondering, you're listening to the news at dawn. I'm your host, Herbie Perlman. If you're one of the perfect audience, you've come to the right place to take a deep breath. Oh, listen to this.
This is Radio Eco Shock with Alex Smith.
Over the past few weeks, planet Earth has experienced a severe climate crisis. It hasn't even made the front page of newspapers or the top story on TV news. This catastrophe will hasten warming of oceans and land, adding to rising seas, threaten more species with extinction, and it will change our whole view of environmental action and what we need to do to save the climate. Massive fires have been burning in Indonesia. In satellite images, large parts of that country and Malaysia and Singapore are buried under smoke. Red dots of fires and hot spots want to cover the whole map of the islands. In a few minutes, I'm going to bring you interviews from two very informed people. We get a report directly from the scene with Dr. Daniel Muryadarso at the Center for International Forestry Research in Bogor, Indonesia. Then I'll thrash through this crisis with one of the long-standing reporters on tropical forests, Bonga Bay founder Rhett Butler. But first, we need to talk. These are not common forest fires as experienced in Western North America, as bad as those were. For one thing, unless climate change prevents it, Western forests are expected to grow back, recapturing some of the carbon. Indonesian tropical forests are not expected to return. They're being replaced with either palm oil plantations or just waste land. At least half of the hundreds of major fires in Indonesia are burning peat, you know, like the peat bales purchased by gardeners, or the peat formerly used in the Middle Ages as fuel. It's a thick layer of very compressed vegetation built up over long ages. About 12% of the land in Southeast Asia is peat swamp forest. 83% of that is in Indonesia. Peat there can be 1 meter deep or 3 feet deep or up to 12 meters or 40 feet deep. And when peat dries out, it begins to emit both carbon dioxide and the more powerful greenhouse gas methane. When peat burns, it releases a mix of toxic dust and gases with grave effects on human health, animal health, and the climate of the world. You can't put out a peat fire with a water bomber or ground crews. The fire goes underground. It smolders and smokes until seasonal rains or snow comes. Some peat fires last for years, resurfacing every year. Tropical peat fires release phenomenal amounts of greenhouse gases. Calculations by the World Resources Institute find that the Indonesian fires over the past 3 months have released more greenhouse gases than the entire annual emissions of highly industrialized Germany. For the past month or so, Indonesia has been emitting more greenhouse gases daily than the entire United States economy. This is a burst of carbon not seen since the last great Indonesian fires in 1997. The Indonesian greenhouse burst throws off all previous calculations of how much carbon we could still burn before crossing the 2-degree unsafe level. It will force a redraw of our models and will create, sooner or later, more swift and unpleasant surprises for all of us in our climate system. The unknowns loom larger.
Radio EcoShock.
Some of us do know that our actions now are determining the fate of the planet for the next few thousand years at least. But our plans and actions and environmentalism have to change. Previously, in my own ignorance, I suggested there are two major stages of climate change. In the first, human greenhouse gas emissions, mainly from burning fossil fuels, create climate disruption and then a hotter world. This is a process we can hope to change as coal goes bankrupt and renewable energy becomes the main source of power. Or it might change because economically recoverable oil runs out, peak oil. We're talking about the scale of human agency. After that, very large natural systems operating as positive feedbacks kick in. For example, scientists know that once giant glaciers begin to retreat, In some parts of the world, simple geography dictates that nothing can stop them from melting into the sea. NASA says we are already at that point with the Totten Glacier in East Antarctica. Another example would be melting frozen methane from the seabed, known as clathrates. When these big so-called natural systems kick in, there may be little humans can do but run toward the mountains and the poles, trying to adapt while killing off the fossil fuel civilization that makes it worse and worse. But now we see there is a third force. The small number of campaigners who work trying to save tropical forests have been trying to tell us this for years, but they've always been a smaller party among the environmentalists and scientists who struggle to stop the orgy of fossil fuel burning. Now we have to open our minds to a horrible new truth. If humans continue to convert the gigantic biomass of tropical forests and peat bogs into carbon in the sky, it may not matter if you install solar panels on your home or stop flying. The current crisis in Indonesia shows us that a less developed country can create more greenhouse gases than the largest industrialized countries in the world. Think about what that means. One result is that environmental campaigners and the public have to quickly become global citizens rather than nationalists. Let's admit it. Hardly anyone in the Americas and few in Europe know anything about Indonesia. We don't need to know. Our societies are self-contained. We go to work. We hope to buy things. We have our family. Who cares? I know some of you will be surprised to learn Indonesia is the fourth most populous country in the world. There are at least 250 million people spread out over thousands of volcanic islands north of Australia and south of the Philippines. Actually, the population is not spread out very much. In 2012, 141 million Indonesians lived on the single island of Java. That's the real center of the country and of the culture. Periodically, the central government in Jakarta, which is on the island of Java, tries to persuade more people to move out to the less populated islands like Sumatra or their part of Borneo known as Kalimantan. We'll hear about Kalimantan in our guest interviews. That's where the dense and toxic smoke has covered everything for over 100 days. The Indonesian government considered an evacuation, but hasn't been able to mount it. Kids play in the smoke while hospitals fill up with babies and the elderly. That's another side of this disaster. At least 500,000 Indonesians have been hospitalized due to breathing difficulties and other health problems caused by the smoke. If the Indonesian economy managed to grow at all this year, all that was lost due to the damage from these fires. Indonesians pay now and directly for this crisis. We will all pay, possibly for centuries, for the greenhouse gases released. This isn't the only terrible climate news recently. Perhaps we'll have time to summarize more of it toward the end of the show. But as the UK Guardian newspaper columnist George Monbiot wrote this week, the fires in Indonesia are, quote, the greatest environmental disaster of the 21st century so far. Let's go to our guests. We'll start with a view from inside Indonesia and then get an activist perspective. We've reached one of the top forestry scientists in Indonesia. Dr. Daniel Murdiarso is senior scientist at the Center for Forestry Research, or CFOR. He's led Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change reports. He has served as Deputy Minister of the Environment for the Government of Indonesia. Dr. Murdiarso, welcome to Radio EcoShock.
Hi, how are you?
Very good, and I'm pleased to talk with you. Could you start by just describing the fire and smoke situation in Indonesia this year? Sort of how many fires are there or hotspots, and where are they located?
Well, this year fire is quite extensive. It spread over the island of Sumatra. There are three big provinces like Riau, Jambi, and South Sumatra. They are all blanketed by smoke these days. The hotspots ranging between 200 to 400 points in the past 3 months or so, and fire still raging as we speak. And in Kalimantan, part of the Borneo island, the number of hotspots is more or less the same, but picking up the highest about 2 weeks ago, about 400 hotspots in west and central Kalimantan.
Is the driving force behind the fires agricultural clearing, forestry operations, or clearing for palm oil plantations?
Well, it's a mix of everything, small and large. But we hardly seen any evidence of logging these days. So it's unlike the 1997 fire was following the logging operation. But these days it's mainly bush and secondary vegetation clear up for agriculture or plantations. Yeah, the same thing happened in both Sumatra and Kalimantan.
Indonesia is the world's largest exporter of palm oil, I understand. So who is buying it and what are they using it for?
Well, the most importer of CPO, the crude palm oil, these days is China and India and also Europe and the U.S. Depending on these countries, the way of palm oil is used is ranging from cosmetic kind of stuff, is household use and cooking oil, edible oil, but also for biofuel. So these countries use oil palm, which is very productive in term of yield in per unit area compared with other vegetative or biofuel produced in Europe or in the U.S.
Yes, I think even the Dutch were burning palm oil in power plants as a green fuel in the sense that it can be replanted and regrown. I want to ask you about climate change now. Forest fires and peat fires have been an annual occurrence for Indonesia, at least since the previous great El Nino year of 1997-98. How does this outbreak compare to recent years and to that 97-98 fire season?
Well, yes, as I said, the 1997 fire, it was also El Nino year, very strong one, prolonged, and at the same time, the conversion of tropical forests was taking place. So following the logging fire happened, and then the extension of agricultural land. But this year, in the past few years, it's mainly bush and secondary forest kind of fire. It's hard to see any logging operation at the moment.
The Western press is reporting that with these fires, greenhouse emissions from Indonesia this year have now surpassed those of the entire U.S. economy. Do you find that credible, and what calculations of emissions do you have?
Well, we have not finished our estimate yet because it's hard to see the precise area burn, as the smoke is still blanketing the area. You cannot see it with Landsat kind of product. You can guess with MODIS or even lower resolution, but it's quite crude. So the most important component to estimate emission is really the emission factor of this material burn, and then the area. And if it's involved, and it is the case involving peatland, then you need to know the depth of peat burn. So that's a very crucial number to get a better estimate of emission.
I think this peat fire angle is very important. I'm wondering if you could explain the mechanism of how and why peat is burning, and maybe give us an idea of the volume of peat that could eventually burn in Indonesia.
Right. Well, once it is exposed, when the peat swamp forest is cut down, and then people start to drain it for agricultural activities, then the peat are exposed and oxidized and dried out, and is prone to fire. So even without fire, draining peatland is also emitting greenhouse gases. But if it is extensive, then it is very sensitive to fire. The first 30 centimeters kind of layer is very sensitive to it, but it does not mean that you can only burn the first few centimeters surface, but it can go deep down in the peat if it is dry enough. That's why we have smoldering instead of raging fire. It's very lack of oxygen, so you have a lot of smoke in the peat fires.
And I've seen that they can go on for years and they're very difficult to put out. I'm wondering, in your opinion, are the Indonesian peat fires perhaps a preview of what could happen in the Arctic as it warms and peat thaws there in the far north?
Well, the process is a bit different because in releasing greenhouse gases in peatland, you need to dry it out and burn. But in the Arctic permafrost, you only need to warm it up. Yes, if the emission of greenhouse gases elsewhere warm the atmosphere up, then the permafrost will be thawed. And that's the time when you release methane, which is more disastrous than CO2. It's got 25 times global warming potential than carbon dioxide.
Let's talk about public health. What are the smoke conditions in Indonesia now? You were just in Jakarta. Is it smoky there?
Well, we are in Bogor, even better here. But I was in the spot 2 weeks ago. This is very, very detrimental. You can see a lot of kids playing around with no awareness about the danger of this haze and smoke, a toxic one. Although they are out of school, but still people are roaming around the city. And I think the worst impact of haze and smoke these days is the health instead of, well, of course, greenhouse gas emission, but the impact to human health is appalling. It's about 43 million people exposed to haze these days, and half a million are affected with these respiratory problems. So I think if you turn that numbers into monetary term, the economic loss is substantial.
Can we expect excess deaths could result from the smoke this year?
Well, there are casualties, cases in Riau province, in South Sumatra. I think that death toll is 10 at the moment. And young baby and elderly people, these are very vulnerable to diseases driven by smoke.
How far has the smoke spread in Southeast Asia? What's happening in Malaysia and Singapore?
Well, it's not much reported. I think they are affected these days, but not like 1997. It was started in July, and the easterly wind affects Singapore very badly. Now it's happening a bit later, so the wind direction is different with 1997-98 fires. I think the disruption of flights and everything is less than the 1997 fires.
This is Radio EcoShock from Bogor, Indonesia. Our guest is forest expert Daniel Murdiarso. What is the Indonesian president, known as Jokowi, saying about this, and what government solutions are being offered, Daniel?
Well, as far as we hear now, the permits to open up the peatland is being reviewed. I think the government will have a very tough measure in terms of issuing new permits in developing peatland especially. They are aware that this is a big mistake to give permits to manage peatland, which is quite sensitive to drought and fire.
What are the challenges at the local level to reducing or ending these annual fires?
I think the hard part of it, if the central government has this kind of policy, then it is not followed by the local government. That's very hard to have this realized. The way I see it, what's happened in the region, it seems that there is no significant move from the local government whatsoever compared with what the central government is trying to help out. But it is really very much depend on how the local government reacted and responds to this call.
Daniel, do you think this problem is manageable, or will Indonesia continue to be one of the world's top emitters of greenhouse gases?
It's hard questions. it's happening year after year, or even in less strong El Nino years, it's also happened. I think this decentralized governance issue is very crucial here to try to help out how this issue is going to be solved in the future. Strong government in the central is not enough if there is no response from the local government, business people who deals with the local government, etc. So it's very complicated. Processes with regard to economic, the political economy, even local political economy.
Do you think this year's burst of greenhouse gas emissions from Indonesia will be raised at the Paris climate talks in December? And if so, is there a role for the international community?
Well, this year, most countries are submitting their what is called INDC. This is the intended national determined contribution in terms of mitigating climate change, including reducing emission. And I'm a bit disappointed that the issue of haze and fire is not mentioned in the Indonesian INDC. So, yeah, it's hard to predict what's going to happen in the next round of negotiation, because one single fire like this is really off scale all the prediction about emission reduction. Numbered all those emission estimates from every sectors.
You know, I'm thinking about Paris, and I'm wondering if there was some sort of international funding mechanism to reduce carbon, however that might work, perhaps that would help local governments make better decisions, because there would actually be a bit of money for not clearing out the peat.
Yeah, well, the Green Climate Fund is been discussed and pledged, but it's only promise. Countries longing to see this to be realized in Paris with a new agreement for towards 2020 and beyond. So I think, as I mentioned earlier, the realization is very much at the central government level. And I think it's timely to propagate this message about the potential of local government to get involved in this process.
Please tell us about the Center for International Forestry Research, where you are, what it does, and the resources that it offers.
Okay, well, C4 is one of the 15 CGIAR centers, the Consultative Group of International Agricultural Research, and we are specializing on forestry, landscape, and people depending on forests and across the tropics. We work in three different kind of portfolio dealing with governance of forests, livelihood and forests and environment. So we basically work mainly on the policy issues and to some extent also on the biophysical aspect of it. We've been supported by a number of countries with an annual budget of about $50 million a year. And what we do is really provide incredible information about those issues related to forests and forest people. And hopefully this will be useful for government and community at large to make their decision, planning, etc.
Is there anything I've missed that you would like to tell our listeners?
Yes, I think this time around with regard to fire is very much a kind of waking up bell to deal with forest and land fire in different way, because usually people are talking about firefighting when it happens, but maybe it's very strategic now to think about fire prevention. So this should be a long-run kind of plan so that we are not surprised if things happen like this every time.
You know, it might interest you to know that we had massive fires in Western North America, and in the village where I live, we had to take in 250 fire refugees, some of whom lost their homes. It was smoky for several weeks. We couldn't really go outside. So I have a fair feeling for what's happening in Indonesia as well.
Yeah, well, it's terrible, terrible. I was there 2 weeks ago in Palangkaraya, the capital of Central Kalimantan. It's so bad. And I was only 5 days there. They've been exposed to a situation like this for more than 100 days. So government are trying to rescue them out. But again, the area which is safe is not ready, and it's a lot of problem too. So it's difficult to cope with this difficult situation in a relatively short period. So as I said, prevention is very crucial.
We've been speaking with Dr. Daniel Murdiarso, the internationally known Indonesian forest expert. He's currently the senior scientist at the Center for Forestry Research, located in Bogor, Indonesia. Dr. Murdiarso, thank you so much for sharing your valuable time. I really appreciate it.
Thank you. All the best.
I'm Alex Smith, reporting for Radio EcoShock.
Shuts, the way the heart unlocks. like something else. A fishing pole, a shoe, an old shirt, a lucky day. Taught me how to win and how to lose and how to fight the crippling blues that I was born with. Bad dreams and nightmares. Ooh, they slip away. Sometime I'll stop looking for you, stop seeing your face every day. Bad dreams and nightmares, big bad wolves. Ooh, I slip away into the remains of the day. Ooh, I slip away into the remains of the day. How to die, but I saw the way the light left your eyes, and after all the shocks, the way the heart unlocks. Ooh, then you slipped away. You slipped away.
You're listening to EcoShock Radio for the world.
I'm Alex Smith. Get it all at our website, ecoshock.org. When you want to know what's happening in the wild places of the tropics, you need to go to mongabay.com. Rhett Butler founded and ran that website and news service starting in 1999. It's gone a lot of places since then, and that includes a Mongabay project in the Indonesian language. And that may explain why Rhett gets those hard-to-find photos like illegal fires burning in an Indonesian national park. So when Indonesia is on fire, as it is right now, it's a real pleasure to welcome you, Rhett Butler, to Radio EcoShock.
Well, thank you. It's a pleasure to be here.
Look, Western environmentalists focus on cutting tailpipe emissions and closing old coal plants. That's important. But we've just seen Indonesia skyrocket almost the number one global source of greenhouse gases, surpassing even the USA. And the cause is not fossil fuels or industry. Rhett, what does this tell us about the new need to protect tropical forests, not just to save exotic animals, but to save ourselves?
Well, right. I mean, that's a good point. So forests are a huge carbon sink. So they store lots of carbon. And so when those forests are cut down and burned, that carbon is released into the atmosphere. So in the case of Indonesia, this activity is particularly damaging because a lot of the forests grow on peat soils. Peat soils are very dense, have very dense organic matter. And when they are drained and then burned, it releases very large amounts of carbon into the atmosphere. And along with that carbon are particulates and other matter that make air pollution very bad. So not only does it help drive the climate change, but it also creates regional and even broader air pollution.
Let's get to some specifics on the ground. Rhett, what are you hearing about the scale of the Indonesian fires this year?
The scale of the fires is truly staggering this year. Typically, fires are lit every year in Indonesia. The difference is that in dry years, the fires can really explode and be out of control. So as your listeners probably know, this is an El Nino year, which means it's very dry in Indonesia. There hasn't been rain for months in some parts of Indonesia. So the result is that these peatlands that have been degraded by oil palm plantations and pulp and paper and other industries are basically a tinderbox. And so when small farmers and land developers lit these fires, they essentially burned out of control. And so now they're spreading into national parks and other forests, and releasing massive amounts of carbon, but also this horrendous air pollution, which is really what neighboring countries care about, because it's creating all sorts of health risks and transportation problems, just because the air pollution is so bad.
Right. They just held a meeting in Vietnam of the ASEAN nations trying to find a solution to this, didn't they?
They did, yeah. So, I mean, this is not a new problem. This problem has been going on for decades, actually. So the last really bad spasm of air pollution, or haze, as they call it in Southeast Asia, was in 1997 and 1998. So in that year, somewhere between 8 and 10 million hectares of land burned. So that's 20 to 25 million acres. And that generated this haze that spread all the way from Australia to Thailand and Singapore and Malaysia. And so that caused a lot of problems. There was an airplane crash linked to that. This year so far is stacking up to be very comparable to 1997 and 1998. So there's been a lot of talk for, you know, almost 20 years on this issue, but very little has actually gotten done.
We just had massive wildfires in Western North America this past summer. Ground and air crews rush out to contain them. Does that happen in Indonesia?
It happens on a much different scale. So the resources in Indonesia are much more limited than we would have in the United States or Canada. It's also, the fires are different because they tend to be burning in peatlands. So the fires will often burn essentially underground. So it's very difficult to extinguish them. An added complication is there's not much water that's available. So they don't have the financial resources, nor do they actually have the physical water they need to put out these fires, which are, you know, very difficult to extinguish anyway because they're burning underground often. So, you know, these are fires that tend to smolder. You put it out in one area and it will pop up in another area. And then, you know, they can easily move into dense forests, which, you know, since they're dried out, they burn, which is not what they would normally do because we're talking about tropical rainforest here. So it's a very difficult situation to address. And really the only thing that's going to put out these fires is when rain returns, and it's not clear when that's going to happen. Some people are projecting in the next couple weeks. Other people say it won't be until January when there'll be enough rain to really extinguish these fires.
Now, I'm trying to figure out the balance. I mean, some of these fires are set by humans, but they're not evil people necessarily. These are people, poor people, who are trying to clear land to feed themselves or to get some sort of economy going. But there are also major corporations, some of them from outside Indonesia, who are part of this. How do you see that balance?
Yeah, so again, it's a difficult situation. It's not clear cut. It's not like it's just big companies, you know, raising the rainforest to produce palm oil. It's much more complex than that. So in many cases, what it is it's small farmers who are clearing vegetation. The cheapest way to do that is by burning, which humans have done, you know, for thousands of years. And so they're just doing what they've always done, clearing land for agriculture to feed their families, but also to, you know, grow crops to earn some money. But the problem now is that the landscape has been so degraded and so changed that these fires aren't limited to small areas. And so that's where the big companies really come in, because they have converted huge areas of what was once forest and peatlands into this ecosystem that now burns easily and very difficult to extinguish fires, especially when it's dry. So what's different now is that companies have come in and really changed the landscape. It's gone from something where fires would typically be pretty limited in scale to something totally different. And so what these primarily palm oil and pulp and paper companies have done is they've dug these large canals and drained the peatlands. And so when you drain the peatlands, it lowers the water table and the peat becomes very combustible. So essentially what these companies have done is they've created conditions that enable these fires. And so then when small farmers come in and start the fires, they are very difficult to put out. But it's not just people in Indonesia who are causing these fires. we in the West bear some responsibility as well because we consume the products that are produced from these areas. So, for example, a lot of snack foods in the United States and cosmetics use palm oil. And so palm oil is being produced on these lands that were once forests and peatlands that are now burning. Same with paper. So pulp and paper is a has traditionally been a huge driver of deforestation in this area, and it's helped create these conditions that lead to these fires.
Oh, you've just mentioned two things that really bother me. And one is it's not just the pulp and paper behind deforestation, because you also have companies who are essentially boiling down the rainforest to make cellulose products for clothes. And that's another whole campaign that's been going on, is to try and get clothing manufacturers to be more responsible so that the orangutans aren't paying for some bit of fashion that you get off the runway.
Yeah, exactly. So, I mean, people, when we talk about timber products and pulp and paper, people forget that a lot of the fabrics that go into clothes are made out of fiber as well. And so this is a concern. And because the fashion industry is, you know, constantly turning over new product, it has a significant environmental impact. And so it also tends to be a place where campaigners can focus, because most people don't want to be associated with destroying orangutan habitat and endangering more species. So a lot of activists see it as an opportunity to try to get big companies to adopt policies that ensure that their sourcing is more responsible. And so that's happening in the fashion industry. It's also happening with the big snack food companies. So that's been an angle to try to encourage better stewardship of forests and peatlands in Indonesia, is by getting these big companies that buy a lot of raw materials to say, okay, we're not going to buy any fiber that's produced at the expense of rainforests.
And then we have palm oil being sold as a green biofuel. I've heard there was a Dutch power plant burning palm oil to be green, but when we see the wreckage on the ground and the carbon emissions that come out from it, it seems like almost a scam to me.
Well, certainly there's a much larger environmental impact from palm oil than most people have been led to believe. And the problem is not so much the palm oil itself, it's how the palm oil is produced. So, you know, traditionally what's happened is that a company will go in and then clear rainforest or peatlands and then convert that area to an oil palm plantation. So traditionally what people have ignored is the fact there's always emissions from that initial land use conversion. And so if you don't count that, then palm oil looks, you know, kind of green. But if you incorporate all the life cycle emissions from palm oil production, then it's a much less environmentally friendly story.
This is Radio EcoShock. We're talking with Rhett Butler from MongaBay.com, and we're talking about the Indonesian crisis, I would call it, although the central government of Indonesia has refused to call this a disaster, as I understand it.
Right. So they haven't used that wording yet, but I mean, it certainly is a crisis. I mean, the president of Indonesia, Jokowi, just flew home from, canceled half of his trip to the United States. This is his first visit ever to the U.S. as a president, in order to deal with these fires. So it is a real concern. I've seen projections saying that the fires are going to cost $50 billion, which is equivalent to 4% of the Indonesian economy. So it essentially wipes out all of its economic growth for the year. And so, you know, while some people may not care about the environment, you know, some policymakers, you know, high-level politicians don't care about so much about the environment. But when you start talking about the economics, then it, you know, becomes a bigger issue. And so a big concern also is kind of the healthcare crisis that's being generated from this. There are 500,000 people who've been hospitalized as a result of the air pollution generated by these fires. So it is a real crisis. Whether it's going to be declared a disaster is kind of a moot point at this stage. It's a very serious problem, that's for sure.
Well, I've seen the central government in Jakarta has banned any further licenses to clear and drain peatlands. But I'm wondering, Rhett, what do you think the chances are that rule can be enforced in the many islands of Indonesia?
Well, so that's always been the challenge. Is Indonesia has a lot of laws on the books that theoretically produce peatlands. But at the same time, it's very difficult to enforce those laws. You know, obviously, Indonesia is known for its corruption, but you have various levels of government. So that's really been the big challenge. So I guess, you know, the question for people is, while the government hasn't passed any new laws since the haze broke out, will people actually care about this issue 6 months from now when the fires are over? Will there still be the momentum to actually address the fundamental problems that have driven this crisis?
Just another complicating factor, the independence movement in Aceh came out with their own land use plan, and it wasn't very progressive or protective. Have you heard about that?
Yeah, so the spatial plan in Aceh has been very controversial. It's been fought over for probably almost 2 years now. And, you know, the Achenese government wants to open up huge areas of forest to industrial mining, oil palm concessions, and logging. So the civil war had kind of prevented a lot of that, or I guess postponed a lot of that conversion that had happened in other parts of Sumatra. So Aceh was seen as kind of the last frontier, the last wild area in Indonesia. But the government is very interested in pursuing that development path that, you know, other parts of Sumatra have pursued, and that will result in essentially, you know, wreckage to the forests.
You would think that a sudden jump in emissions would be raised at the Paris climate talks coming up in December, but my understanding is that Indonesia doesn't mention control of tropical fires in their emissions reduction plan. What are the forest preservation people hoping will happen in Paris?
Well, I think these fires have changed the conversation. I mean, it's such a hot topic right now. I can't imagine that there won't be pressure around this once the climate talks start. I know that the U.S. government, Singaporean governments are very concerned about this issue. So I would believe that it's an issue that will be raised and will be at least discussed in some degree. I mean, it's hard to say whether it'll be built into their climate pledge or not, but I honestly don't see how Indonesia could possibly meet its emissions commitment without addressing this fundamental problem.
You're listening to WZBC Newton 90.3 FM. This is the News at Dawn. Any views you hear on this program are not those of this station, Boston College, or its Board of Trustees.
Will you be going to Paris?
I will not be going to Paris, but Manga Bay has three correspondents who will be there, so they'll be covering the action.
Well, we'll look for that. You do operate a new site that's become a hub for vital information. Are there other stories from Indonesia that have caught your attention and maybe make you worry a bit?
Oh, well, there's plenty to worry about in Indonesia right now. So even before the fires, there was huge concern about kind of this backlash against these companies that have adopted zero deforestation commitments. So the government, and, you know, it's a little bit hard to define who in the government, but let's say elements in the government have been very strongly opposed to these zero deforestation commitments. And again, these zero deforestation commitments have emerged as a response to consumers and companies who are concerned about being associated with destructive practices. And so a bunch of U.S., European, Canadian companies have established safeguards for palm oil and other commodity sourcing, which basically says we will not buy palm oil to produce at the expense of rainforest, peatlands, or as a result of human rights abuses. And so these Indonesian companies, several Indonesian companies have adopted these policies, but the Indonesian government is now putting pressure on these companies to not maintain those policies, to, you know, not respect them. And at the same time,